Hi, and welcome to the Real Estate of Mind show. We are your hosts, Glenn and Amber Schwarm, and we help everyday people create wealth through real estate. And we have an awesome show outlined for you today. Today, we're going to talk about the five best ways that you can fund your business or your flip.
Money is probably the most important thing. When people look to finance their deal, people say, oh my gosh, I don't have any money. That's the most common thing I always hear is, I say, what do you think you lack to be a real estate investor? And the first thing they say is money. And when we started, we literally were $80,000 in credit card debt and didn't know which way to turn, but I knew we'd get access to money, and that's what we want to talk about today.
And I think, you know, even when people come to our workshops, that's like the biggest fear they have to overcome, or the reason they think they can't get into real estate or they can't flip houses because they don't have money. But we're going to teach you in this podcast how to use other people's money to get your business going and to fund your flips. It's really the best way to get started in investing in real estate. Would you agree?
Oh, yeah. These are in no specific order we're going to go into today, but we know what we've used a lot. We're going to share with you those different methods that we use.
So the first method that we're going to talk about is private money. And that's when you may, you know, go to someone that you know, a family member, a friend, an acquaintance. You know, there's all sorts of money out there. So Glenn's going to talk about private money.
This is how we have built our business and done, to date, $58 million worth of business, 59, whatever it is now. This is how we have done it, with other people's money and primarily through private money, private lending. Amber mentioned, you know, at our course, at our home flipping workshops, we go into all these different methods in detail. And today we don't have time to go into in great detail, but we're going to jump into it and give you an idea of what it's all about. So the pros. The pros of this are it's easy and fast, and it could be less expensive than like a hard money lender or other people, other sources that we're going to talk about here in just a minute. So that's one of the ways. The cons are the interest rates, and some people have limited funds. So when you go to a traditional hard money lender, which I don't know if we're going to cover that today. When we cover the hard money lenders, when you go to a hard money lender, they have unlimited funds, but they're more expensive. You're going to pay points and you're going to pay a higher interest rate, and there's some fees and whatnot involved with that. With a private lender, you get to negotiate that rate yourself. And people think that private lenders are people that are wealthy. They're not. They're just people that want to invest their money and get a better rate of return. Our investors are great, everyday, salt of the earth people. They are people that have saved money in their lifetime. They have, you know, $50,000, $100,000, $200,000 in their IRA, and we help them convert their IRA into what's called a self-directed IRA. And therefore, they can use that money and get 10%, 12%, whatever it might be on their money, where maybe in the stock market they're not getting that. And I always say, too, with private money, it's not sexy for the investor. What I mean is, it's, you know, if you go to the stock market, if you like this, if you like going, we're rich, we're poor, we're rich, we're broke, we're rich, let's move. If you like that lifestyle, that's kind of what the stock market does for you. It drives you nuts. But that's the ride of a stock market, where we currently pay our investors 10%. Now, it's not sexy, but it's steady year in, year out, day in, day out. That's what they get. It's a constant climb with us. And I'll tell you, the very first investor we ever had, just kind of how we got this story, Amber was working out with her at the gym.
Yeah, when I first moved to New York, I went to a gym and I started working out, and I became friends with this girl, and we worked out every day. And, you know, lo and behold, we found out that, well, when we first started investing in real estate, our first few houses, we were able to get, it was a different time then. We did they call them no-doc loans. We didn't have to show proof of income or anything like that. And credit cards. So we did that, but then those went away. So we had to kind of scramble because we had a deal under this on the table, and we needed to find money. So I got to talking to her and found out that she had a lot of equity in her house.
We both said, equity.
And she wanted to put her kids through private school too and couldn't afford it at the time. So
we helped her set up, get her home equity in place. She loaned us $100,000 out of her home equity. So she was paying 4% on that money. We agreed to pay the minimum payment every month of like $350 a month. So we paid the interest on that money. We then paid her back then at the time. She got 14%, okay, on money that she was borrowing at 4%. So she was using other people's money to loan us. We had secondhand other people's money, right? So she was making 10% on the spread. In other words, she was paying 4. We were paying it 4. We were paying her 14, 10%. Put her kids through private school just for that. And to this day, 12 years later, she's still an investor with us and been doing great. Her nest egg has grown. Now she's turned over other things. So pretty great. But that's the idea of private money.
And some of you probably caught this, but I said a minute ago that we had a deal. We had, and that funding from the bank was gone. So we had to find money so that we could do that deal.
Yeah, we
and
lost it.
Glenn actually always talks about that in some of his trainings, is that's kind of a neat way to do things, is you trap yourself. You know, you don't have to find the money first. Find the deal and then go out and find the money for it. And a lot of times when you're wanting to get private money from an investor, it's good for them to see the deal and see the numbers, and you can present that to them, and that makes them more comfortable with investing in you as well.
Yeah, we had actually bought that back. Our actual story was, we bought the house and then the bank said, we're not doing that program anymore. I said, no, you can do it with me. And they said, no, that program is gone. Remember, this is back in 2008 when the market was crashing. So when the huge collapse happened in the country. And so right during that time, that's when the bank said no. We were literally under contract, getting ready to close, and they yanked our financing from us. So we had to figure it out, and that's what we did. So
method number two is going to be using lines of credit. That could be credit cards, it could be a HELOC or a home equity line of credit, or even a retirement account.
So let's talk about that, kind of some pros and cons of it. So the pros are, it's easy, it's an ongoing source. So once you have that, line of credit, whatever it might be, if it's a HELOC or HELOC is a home equity line, like Amber said, or if you want to borrow from your retirement or whatever it might be, that is a good ongoing source of cash for you. Once you pay it back, it's available within another day. You don't have to ask anybody for it. It's there. So if you have credit lines, that's a really good thing to do. The cons are, you could be putting your house or your retirement at risk. So if you borrow from yourself on your home equity and something goes south, well, you know, that's your home. Your home is the protector. Now, I always say that real estate, if you think about it, it's very tough to actually lose a lot of money in real estate. You can, but it's tough because it's an actual asset. You'd have to go out of your way to not put insurance on a house. And, even if a house burns to the ground, you have no insurance, which would be a bad mistake. But even if it did, you still have the piece of property and probably the foundation in place. So that's probably worth 40, 50 grand by itself. So it's tough to lose everything, just to keep that in mind, okay? You could, but you'd have to really try.
Yeah, and investing in real estate is making an educated decision to invest your money. And that's why we, like at our workshops, we give out the home flipping evaluator and the home flipping checklist. You don't want to just go in a house and guess, like, oh, I think this is going to be, $30,000 to renovate. You want to go in a house and know your numbers, know your cost, and be able to make an educated decision on that. And then it's a very calculated decision, and the risk is very, very low.
Part of the credit lines, too, is credit cards. Now, people don't think about credit cards as a means to finance a house. That's how we did it, and we still actually do a lot to this day, is we use credit cards. In the early days, we would get the loan from the bank. That was the first other people's money that we used. And then we'd use credit cards to do the renovations and the buying the material and all those things. So we had options that were there. So how do you do that? You can go and apply for 0% credit cards. Little plug for us here. If you want to learn how to get multiple cards and really maximize your credit lines to get 0%, we have an awesome program. We teach our students. Just reach out to us, give us a comment, whatever. We'd love to help you learn how you can get massive lines of credit at 0% interest for, 12 to 15 months, which is awesome.
And the other great thing about credit cards, and why we still use them to this day, is credit card points. You can use those, you can let them add up. You can actually cash those in for cash. You can make your credit card payments with those points. You can, we like to save them up. I hoard them for travel. Yeah. I love to travel for free. So, we've been all over the world. We've been to Thailand and Bonaire and Curacao and, all over the place using our credit card points. And when you're doing renovations, they add up pretty quickly, which is really fun.
Yeah. So, again, the way we got started was doing that. We used our credit cards. We used our HELOC. We did everything we had to. We used credit lines to get where we had to get money. Again, that's access to other people's money. You probably have that in your wallet, in your money clip, in your purse right now. And just by making some calls, and again, if you want to call us, we'd be happy to help you get $30,000, $50,000, $80,000 in 0% credit card, because you have to know where to go. We can help you with that. But anyways, that's not what I'm here to talk about today, but just letting you know that's one of the many options. So
the next one is hard money lenders. And that might sound a little scary to some people. It might sound like you're getting money from the mob or something like that. But these are really institutional lenders that are ready and designed for taking those higher risks.
Right. So the pros are, they're easier than a bank, right? Banks don't really lend to real estate investors. They can, but not really. But that's one of the pros, is that they're easier to get the money from. The cons are, they're expensive. And sometimes you have to give your kidney or your arm.
Or your firstborn.
No, you don't really have it. Depends if you like your kid or not. You may not want to. So, but I'm telling you something. With the hard money lenders,
it's a means to an end.
It is. And certainly we've used them in the past. We have private lenders. We've used hard money lenders. They are available. Many of our students use hard money lenders to get started and kind of get their feet wet and learn how to do this. But
there's powerful. Plenty of times where if the numbers work, even with a higher interest loan, do the deal. It's still worth it to do the deal.
I say in my workshop, if a deal is, you know, 6 points, by the way, they're going to charge you points when you do a hard money. A point, 1 point equals 1% of the loan. So in other words, if you borrowed $100,000, 1 point of that is $1,000 or 1%. So if a loan is 5 points, so let's say that's $5,000, that's the price you pay for that money. And let's say it's $5,000 for the points, and then you're going to pay 15% interest. You may say it's highway robbery. That's just what happens for short-term money in the real estate world. That's very normal. However, you look at the whole deal. If you said to yourself, after I flipped and did everything, I can make $40,000 even after paying the high interest rate, why wouldn't you do it? So sometimes you have to lose the battle to win the war. Don't, you know, what do they say? Cut off your nose to spite your face. You're going to say, I won't do that deal because your rates are too high. Well, guess what? The next investor will come along and do it and take the money at the high rate and they'll make $40,000. So don't get so focused on the amount or the cost of the money. Factor it, but don't get so wrapped up that you don't make a smart business decision with that. And how to find these things? Google. That's how you can start finding. Google. Reach out to us if you'd like to. We have some great lenders we work with too. We can be happy to connect you with. But there are some reputable people. There are some not reputable people as well. So you want to be careful with that. But you want to make sure you get the right people that are in the business to do this for a living. Okay.
So the fourth method we're going to talk about is owner financing. And that's when the owner of the house or the property acts like the bank.
So what are the pros and cons to that? Pros are it's very simple and negotiations are easy and you set all of the terms, right? You negotiate with the person, you set the terms. They become the bank, right? There's actually no money that changes hands, just on a piece of paper. They're saying to you, I will finance this house for you. And this can be done short-term or long-term. But let's say you're going to flip a house for argument's sake. You could do a short-term loan with somebody and say, look at, you know, you want $100,000 for your house. I want to pay you $90,000 for the house because you're factoring in the cost of your money. You may say to them, tell you what, I'll give you your $100,000 if you give me a 0% loan for 6 months. And what will happen is I'll flip the house. You'll have a mortgage on the house. And then, boom, when I'm done, I have to pay that mortgage off. Now, they may say, I'm not giving that money for free. I want 3%, 5%, 10%, whatever. And you can negotiate. But the point is, it's fully negotiable, fully negotiable. The cons are not every seller can do it. Not every seller is in a position where they can do that for you. They may be behind on their mortgage. They may not own the house outright. And you can do it. There's ways you can do it with the house paid off and not paid off. We're going to talk about that next. But they may not be able to. It might be an estate situation where they say, no, we have 5 siblings. They want their cash now. They don't want to do it. So not every seller can do that. But I think it's powerful to at least ask.
Absolutely. We've done really well on that. Actually, one of the very first houses we ever did, we're talking about private investors and all this money.
Yeah.
So one of the very first houses we ever did, we went to the closing table and we got our portion of what we agreed on and they got their portion.
Let me back up. Because it was an owner finance kind of a deal.
Right.
Very unique situation. I'll let you finish that part of it. But the pre-story to that is we went to them and said, here's a cash offer. And by the way, we had no idea where to get the money from because the banks had just shut down that program. So we gave them a cash offer, which we didn't have the cash. And then we said, or here's an owner finance offer that they made $10,000 more on. And we said, it'd be a short-term deal. And they ended up, they said, we're going to go with plan B. And we said, okay, thank God, because I didn't have a plan A. So that worked out. But at the closing table, now I'll go back to your story.
Yeah, so we're sitting at the closing table. We got our money, they got theirs. And I believe theirs was what, like $60,000?
Yep. Yeah, it was
$60,000. Yeah, $60,000. And I said, so what you going to do with that money? And they said, well, we don't really know. So to this day, and this is what, 12 years later?
12, 13
years later, they are still private investors with us. And they've even turned over a lot of their retirement, or maybe all of their retirement.
I don't know, but a lot of it. Yeah.
A lot of their retirement over to us to invest as well in a self-directed IRA.
Great people, and we've become great friends, and just kind of salt of the earth people that, you know, he worked for the local power company here for many years, retired, and had a little nest egg he wanted to invest with, and now he gets way better returns than a lot of his people do. that he associates with, and he's secure. He knows he can drive here and see our office. He knows who we are, and it's pretty cool.
Yeah, and sometimes all you have to do is ask.
Yeah.
And people, you know, you might be surprised at who has money and who.
It's a simple thing to ask. Right. And if you don't ask, you don't know.
You don't know. There's also a side door approach too. You might just ask someone, you know, if you're a little intimidated to ask someone outright if they have any money, you might ask them, hey, do you know anybody who might like to be a private investor? And then all of a sudden they might say, well, I might want to.
Right.
So the last one that we're going to talk about is subject to financing. And this is when you take over payments of an existing loan from somebody else.
So subject to means that you buy the house subject to any existing liens on the property. That means a mortgage, a tax lien, any other judgments that might be on a house. But you take over the house knowing full well that there are liens on that house or a mortgage on that house. You can do this. You can actually take title to a house, and the mortgage actually stays in the original owner's name or whoever's name it is, but you have to make payments on that. Some of the pros to this are, most of the time, the seller probably got a mortgage that was at a lower rate, like a 4%, 3%. You know, it's a very low interest rate mortgage. So you're not paying the high hard money or private money, 10%, 15%. You're not paying those rates. You can take over the payments and do that. You're making payments on this property. If you don't make payments, the bank can still foreclose, okay, and you'll lose the house because the house is in your name, but there's still a mortgage or a lien on that property. I'm going to implore you, I'm going to beg of you, please, if you ever consider this method, you have to make those payments timely. Now, what do you think happens to somebody who is falling behind in payments? Maybe you have to make a couple payments and bring them current, and their credit was starting to be destroyed by not making a mortgage payment. Now you start making the payments for them. Good or bad? Great. Right? When you make a mortgage payment, that really helps improve people's credit score. So you're doing a great thing by doing that. It's really good for a short-term project where you can take over their payments, you can relieve that debt from them because you're starting to make payments on that loan, okay? You're now making the payments for them. The house is in your name. You can fix the house, renovate it, do what you gotta do, flip it, and boom, away you go. You're all set. When you sell that house, you have to pay off that mortgage because it's still a lien on the property. Right, it was a lien when it started. It's still a lien on the property. So,
yep.
Sounds a little complex, but bottom line is that if somebody has a mortgage on the property, you can take over the house, make the mortgage payments, and help them out of a tough situation and find a deal for yourself too.
So, the thing that I think is really cool about all of these methods and real estate in general is that you get to be really creative even in the financing part of it, because you don't have to just take one of these methods to do the house. You can combine one or two or three of the methods. You can do whatever you have to do that the seller is agreeable with, and you know, you can get as creative as you want to be, as long as, you know, and like Glenn was saying, everything's negotiable.
You may have a deal. Take this. It's just a random idea, but this has happened. Things like this have happened to us. You may have a private investor that only has $50,000 they want to invest in a property, but you want to buy a property that's $150,000 to buy and renovate. That's the money you want. So you might get $50,000 from a private lender. You may have $20,000 in a private line of credit or credit cards that you have you want to use for that. Maybe the seller will be willing to hold $30,000 themselves. You know what I mean? You can actually literally combine many methods to get this done. And so all the methods that we talk about, you may get a hard money lender for a small chunk of it. You can have multiple private lenders or multiple people. And so the cool part about real estate is it's an awesome business and awesome career because you get to be creative with the financing. You get to figure out how it works. So it's a win-win, 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 win-win for everybody that gets involved in the deal. You can have 10 friends that give you 10 grand each. You know, and that's maybe all they have. They give it to you on their credit cards. And so you pay them, and you can make this up as you go along. If there's a will, there's a way. And if you have a strong enough why, the how will always figure itself out. So it's a great, great business. Combine these methods. This is just a few of the methods we talk about.
So if you're serious about investing in real estate and money is the thing that's been holding you back, no more excuses.
No more.
there are tried and true and proven ways to get the job done if you really want to get it done. So
totally.
Let's recap the five methods.
Do it.
Number one is private money.
Yep.
Number two is credit lines. Number three is hard money lenders. Number four is owner financing. And then number five is subject to financing.
Yep. Fantastic. So, am I going to close it up?
No.
Oh, so.
Get with the program, honey.
I'm sorry. I'm not doing something.
He missed his cue.
So you deserve to live your best life now, you deserve to create wealth through real estate investing, and that's what we do. And you deserve to have the best life you can come up with. And so all these little things that we do and these podcasts that we do are really designed to give you tools and techniques and tips and encourage you to go out there and build the life that you want to for yourself.
Yep. So you have been listening to the Real Estate of Mind show. Again, we are your hosts, Glenn and Amber Schwarm. If you found value in this podcast, wherever you're listening to it, Apple, iTunes, YouTube, whatever, give us a thumbs up, share it with your friends. It lets us know that you guys find value in this so that we keep doing it for you guys. You can find us on social media, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, all that good stuff under Glenn and Amber Schwarm.
Remember, everyday people really do create wealth through real estate investing. The only question is, will you be next?
So we have another great topic for you coming up next week. And make sure, you know, if you do have questions, send those along. We'd love to answer them for you. So we'll see you next time.
We'll see you then.